And thank you all of you for coming here and sharing the excitement of the night with us tonight. I should correct one thing Tim said, what wasn't quite correct, that the galaxy we discovered was not 3 billion light years away, it was 13 billion light years away. So he reduced the age of the universe by quite a significant amount. So that would have been, we would not have been here if that had been the farthest galaxy. So the sciences, the arts, and the humanities may seem as far apart as one could imagine. Yet, the wonderful field of astronomy I have found is a bridge that spans them. Astronomy can provide the largest landscape that inspires artists and poets. Art is what words cannot express. Poetry is imagination expressed in words, and astronomy stretches the limits of human imagination. On the wings of this imagination, we set for a journey to the depth of space and beginning of time, to a place where no one has been, a journey which does not exhaust us physically, but enriches us intellectually. What we learn in this journey is to know ourselves better and our position in the world, an education which would stay with us for the rest of our lives. It's the same as we enjoy listening to music without knowing how to play an instrument, and enjoy looking at a painting without knowing how to paint. Astronomy we could enjoy without knowing physics or mathematics. Now let's start it. So we start with an image of galaxies, and this is an image taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. We took this image some years ago, and every point here, every single dot here is a galaxy containing on average 100,000 million stars. So even the smallest of them, the smallest of the dots here are galaxies which have 100,000 million stars on average. And these are indeed at the edge of the observable universe, what we see. So I start my talk with a set of questions. How the universe started? How galaxies were formed in the universe? Are there other planets like the Earth? Is the universe open or closed? What is the main content of our universe? Can we see the galaxies, the first generation of galaxies? And how is the universe going to end? By the end of this talk, you should know the answer to all these questions. What I expect you to do and hope you to do is when you leave this room tonight, you'll be either convinced or confused, but not indifferent. So scientific astronomy started by ancient Greeks. The first one who produced a model for the universe was Ptolemy. He put the Earth at the center of the universe. Today, we know this is wrong, but that was a big leap forward, starting to scientifically think about the world out there. Then, about 1,700 years later, Copernicus removed the Earth from the center of the universe and put the Sun in the center of the universe. Today, again, we know the Sun is not the center of the universe. But imagine he fought 1,700 years of thinking that the Earth was the center of the universe and fought with that and changed that attitude, that idea, that needed some courage by itself. So that was Copernican Revolution. By the way, I used to look like him when I had hair. And then Isaac Newton, the greatest scientist of all times, he invented calculus. And those who don't like calculus, the students, you should hate Newton, because he is the one who invented that. However, without calculus, we would not have been able to do many things we do today. Here, we see the physics, the mathematics at work. That's action-reaction, the third law of Newton. So that, with that, we send a rocket up, and we send it to the Hubble Space Telescope to repair it. And this is how we see the mathematics at work, working. It took us 1,700 years to remove the Earth from the center of the universe and put the Sun at the center of the universe. It took us 100 years to get from here there. exactly 100 years after the Wright brothers built the first plane, mankind sent the space shuttle up to repair the Hubble Space Telescope, exactly about 100 years. And this shows the rate with which the science has been progressing. What happens over the next 100 years, that's anyone's guess. If I've seen further, it is by standing on the shoulder of giants, Isaac Newton. However, cosmology as a science started early in the 20th century. Today, we know that the universe started from the Big Bang about 13.8 billion years ago. So 13.8 billion years ago, the universe started from a Big Bang. And since then, it's been expanding. It's a big explosion which happened at that time. And since then, for 13.8 billion years, all everything, the space is expanding, and everything is moving away from everything else. What happened before the Big Bang, we may touch on that. But at the time of the Big Bang, space and time came to be. So what was before the Big Bang? In answer to the question of why it happened, I offered the modest proposal that our universe is one of those things which happen from time to time. So that's a complicated question, and we come and discuss that. But for now, we leave it. And I go through a few minutes of background knowledge so that I could build up on that to study the beginning to the evolution of the universe. So everything around us is built up of atoms. Atoms consist of a nucleus which contains protons and neutrons. And around protons and neutrons are electrons. So nucleus is protons, neutrons, collectively called nucleons, and around that, electrons are moving. This is the structure of an atom. The protons and neutrons themselves consist of quarks. Each proton consists of three quarks. Each neutron consists of three quarks. So quarks are the basic elements forming the matter in the universe. So at the very beginning, when the universe started, the quarks came, and how this happened is a long story. And I just to make it short, quarks came to form the protons and neutrons called hadrons. But the intensity of radiation, at that time there was nothing but radiation, but light. Intensity of the radiation destroyed them. So as soon as they come to form the hadrons, the protons, they are hit by photons, by radiation, and they are destroyed. Meanwhile, the universe is expanding, meaning that the energy of photons is reducing, is going down. It took a few fraction of a second until the energy of light became so low that could no longer destroy the protons and neutrons. At that point, protons and neutrons were formed. And then protons and neutrons start, and that was about 1,000th of a second after the beginning of the universe. And then protons and neutrons started to come together to form elements. So you have the nucleus, protons and neutrons, electrons moving around that. The simplest of the atoms has one proton, that's hydrogen. So that's at the center. So that is the simplest of the atoms, the lightest of the elements. Next one, helium, and so on, so forth. By changing the number of protons in the nucleus of an atom, you change the type of an atom. So therefore, by putting more protons, you get heavier and heavier elements, and so on. And this is how the elements were built. However, at the very beginning, it was the lightest of the elements, hydrogen and helium. And it took about 3 minutes for these to come and form these elements. To be precise, 2 minutes, 56 seconds after the Big Bang, after the beginning of the universe, when these elements came and started to form the lightest of the elements. At that point, 75% of the elements were locked in the hydrogen and 25% in the helium. And this is 3 minutes after the beginning of the universe. By 12 minutes after the beginning of the universe, all this process was done. Hydrogen and helium were there. So the hydrogen we have around us today, the hydrogen you have in the water you drink is left over from 3 minutes after the Big Bang, from the beginning of the universe. Hydrogen cannot be produced in stars throughout the evolution of the universe or evolution of stars. So anything hydrogen and helium is around us today is basically left over from the first 3 minutes in the history of the universe. Meanwhile, the universe expands. So then the atoms come, atoms start to form. form the atoms, the protons, the electrons come and sit around the nucleus to form the atom. But the energy of radiation is so high that as soon as electron sits there, it's kicked out by the radiation. So the atoms are not formed until 300,000 years after the Big Bang, when the energy of light reduces to an amount that could no longer kick out the electron from the atom. At that point, the first atoms are formed, atoms of hydrogen. That was about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. So at that point, there was nothing but matter in the form of atoms and radiation interacting with one another. And as the universe expanded, at some point, these two decoupled. The matter went around to form the matter. At this point, the matter went around to form stars, galaxies, planets, and eventually us, and the radiation filling the universe as cosmic background radiation we have today. So these are basically the remnants at the very beginning of the universe at that time. And at that point, what happens is that, as I said, the protons come, they combine and form heavier and heavier elements. And this is the process which happens. I'm not going to go through that, but from hydrogen, you come and get helium at the first 3 minutes after the Big Bang. You get helium, 4 means it has 2 protons, 2 neutrons. Helium has 4, 2 protons and 2 neutrons. And this is important, I'll come and discuss it, why it's important. So this is the nucleosynthesis and the product at the very beginning. Meanwhile, the universe is expanding. The universe is expanding, the matter and radiation decoupled. The radiation is in the form of cosmic background radiation today. So 300,000 years after the Big Bang, matter and radiation were interacting with one another. Therefore, any distribution of matter was imprinted into radiation. So this shows the distribution of temperature of the radiation when the universe was 300,000 years old. The red points are the hot points, hot regions. The blue points, the colder regions. So this, the red points, therefore, where the matter was more, there were more matter. The blue points, where there were less matter. So here, we can see the distribution of matter very early in the history of the universe. And these red points, the matter clumps, basically evolved and formed stars and galaxies we have today, eventually us. And this is basically a result of that billions of years after that time. So during this time, I told you that the hydrogen was formed. And when the hydrogen was formed, it started to absorb the radiation coming down out from the Big Bang. And this way, it could not reach out of the universe, out to us. And at this point, the universe went through 600 million years of dark ages, something we call dark ages, because the radiation was not allowed, could not escape from the universe to reach us. And this lasted until the first stars and galaxies were formed, which they ionized the universe and started to make the universe transparent. The reason that the universe is transparent today is because of that first generation of stars and galaxies. Now, can we see those? We come and discuss that. So dark ages lasted until about 1 billion years after the Big Bang. At 1 billion years after the Big Bang, the first generation of stars and galaxies formed. And those stars and galaxies eventually evolved and formed us and made the universe transparent as compared to being opaque before the time before that. So just to summarize what I said, we are living on a planet called like the Earth. The Earth is a small planet in the solar system. Solar system is a system on the disk of the Milky Way galaxy, our own galaxy, which is going around the sun, all the planets. And there are 100,000 million stars like the sun in the Milky Way galaxy. And there are 100,000 million galaxies like the Milky Way in the observable universe. And then Milky Way is a part of local supercluster, which is moving towards a greater cluster called the Virgo cluster, with a speed of about 480 kilometers per second. So this is the structure we are in. And we are such a small part of this structure, this whole structure. We are insignificant being living on a small planet of a very average star, and yet understand the universe. This is by itself something. We have to be proud of ourselves. Now, One thing we do, and I do in my research group, my student, is to look or search for the first generation of galaxies. How do we do that? So, so by doing that, I'll give you an example. When you go out tonight and look at the sky, essentially you look back in time. So the light from the sun takes 8 minutes to reach us. Therefore, we see the sun as it was 8 minutes ago, not as it is now. Similarly, if you see a galaxy which is 8 million light years away, you see that galaxy as it was 8 million years ago, not as it is today. If you look further, find a galaxy which is 13 billion light years away, you see that galaxy as it was 13 billion years ago, not as it is today. That galaxy may not exist today. So the light from that has taken 13 billion years to reach us. By the time the light left that galaxy, our own galaxy was not here, our sun was not here, we were not here. And it took that long to reach us. Therefore, given that the age of the universe is 13 billion years, if we find a galaxy there, we essentially find the first generation of galaxies, because we are looking back 13 billion years to 13 billion years ago. This is the method we use to find the most distant galaxies in the universe. And this is exactly what happens. So we are sitting here with our telescopes looking back in time. And the galaxies we have found are at the edge of the dark ages. In fact, the kind of galaxies we find are basically 1 billion years after the Big Bang, the beginning of the universe. So by pushing this further and further back in time, we could find the first generation of galaxies. And we could understand or study how the universe itself started to form the galaxies as we see them. A few years ago, I was working for NASA at Space Telescope Science Institute. And my colleagues and I got together one day and discussed, now that we have the Hubble in the orbit, what should we do to get the deepest image ever seen by the mankind of the universe? After about a year discussion and analysis and calculations, we came up with the idea of Hubble Ultra Deep Field, the deepest image ever taken by the universe. So we put Hubble at one point and stared at one single part, one small part of the universe for 400 hours and collected photons, radiation. The result was an image, the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, the deepest image ever seen by the mankind. And this is the image of the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. The galaxies you see here, again, these small dots are all small galaxies at the edge of the observable universe. Every one of them contains 100,000 million stars on average. With this, you're looking at the edge of the observable universe, the most distant galaxies you can find here. You can see furthest away and the deepest image ever seen by the mankind since when the civilization started. And we can see that. And for many years to come, this would be the deepest image ever seen by the mankind. And here is one of the most distant galaxies found there. Again, this galaxy is almost about 1 billion years after the Big Bang, this red point. Today, that may not exist. And today, this you are seeing, you're essentially seeing what it was about over 12 billion years ago. And then the first generation of stars and galaxies formed. They started to come together and evolve and form the galaxies we see today. Failing is bad, but worse is not trying to succeed. Throughout this study, finding the remotest, the most distant galaxies in the universe, we find many false hope. We find many galaxies which eventually find out to be false. So we failed. But eventually we find one which we can confirm that's the most distant. And that's very, very exciting. So what I keep telling to my students is that I would not be upset if you fail, but I will be upset if you don't try to succeed. Galaxies form and come together, merge, and form bigger and bigger galaxies. And this is two galaxies caught in the process of mergers. Our own galaxy went through this billions of years ago. And this is the way to make more massive galaxies as galaxies we have today. So we have gone through the history of the universe, started from the Big Bang and just going further, forward in the history of the universe to where the galaxies formed and then evolved to reach where we are here. So we started from here and basically moved towards present time to study the history of the universe. Now, what is the space in the space between galaxies? When you look at the space between galaxies, it's darkness, it's nothing there. Is it really nothing there? Is it vacuum? Is it just empty? So the space between galaxies is filled by hydrogen. Hydrogen, as I said, is the most abundant element in the universe. 75% of all the elements is in the form of hydrogen. 25% helium. The rest, the heavy elements, which forms us, is a very small, very insignificant part of the universe, less than 1% of the elements in the universe. So by looking at this, we can find out that essentially the space between galaxies is filled with hydrogen, hydrogen, molecular hydrogen, the cold hydrogen. And this is how it's found. So you find a very bright galaxy, a star, a galaxy or quasar, and you look at the light from that. The light from that goes through all the structures in the universe, all the matter in the universe. And eventually, when you look at the spectrum of the light, you see at some wavelength, this is the wavelength of the light, all the light is absorbed. This means that there is matter between us and that galaxy which absorbs the light. And suddenly, it goes up like this. So this implies that there's something in the space between galaxies, that some matter between galaxies. It's not totally empty. Now, what is the content of the universe? As I said, the universe contains 100,000 million galaxies, the observable universe. In each galaxy, 100,000 million stars. And that is only 4% of the universe. 96% of the universe we cannot see. It's in the form of dark matter or dark energy. So it's basically 73% of the universe is in the form of dark energy, and 23% dark matter. And only 4% is the matter we see at night, or matter constituting our bodies. Only 4% of the universe is of that matter. The rest is dark matter, dark energy we cannot see. We have some idea what dark matter might be. We have no idea what dark energy is. And then, this is important, because depending on the amount of dark matter in the universe or dark energy, the universe could be closed or open. If the amount of dark matter is more than a certain value, that could close the universe. So here, if the universe, if the amount of dark matter is higher than the critical value, the present expansion would stop at some point, and the universe would collapse on itself, ending up in a big crunch. It was possible that previous universes, there might have been previous universes, which went through this big crunch and then started a new universe. There's no way for us to know about this, because we get no signal from those universes. But this is a possibility. So if the amount of dark matter is smaller than the critical value set by Einstein's theory of general relativity, then the universe is open and the expansion would continue forever. So this is the reason it's important to know about dark matter and dark energy. So dark matter, as I said, is 96% of the total matter in the universe is dark. Only 4% is in the form we see. And this is how we find it. So we look at the galaxy far away. So we see the light from the galaxy coming there. Then we put some matter between us and the galaxy. So that deflects the light based on Einstein's theories and produces a distorted image of that galaxy there. The amount of that distortion tells us about the matter between that galaxy and us. So this way, we could find the mass of the universe. We could weigh the universe. This process called gravitational lensing, this matter, it doesn't matter if it is light, if it emits light or not, if it's dark or luminous. It has gravity, it is matter, it has gravity. And that gravity bends the light. And this is why there is dark matter. And this is an image, a real image taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. And you see here these distortions. These would tell us about the matter between us and those galaxies. And that could constrain the amount of dark matter in the universe. And a few years ago, in 2007, we really measured the distribution of dark matter in the universe. In one of the largest surveys taken by the Hubble Space Telescope, we managed to do that. And this way, this is the time. You look back in time, and this is the distribution of dark matter as a function of time in the universe. It's very, very difficult measurement. It's like, it's like sending a blind man into a dark room looking for a black cat and finding it. So it's as hard to find this distribution as it is here. We made mistakes, and we did indeed, but a person who never made a mistake never tried anything new. So do not be afraid of making mistakes. You learn from mistakes. The important thing is not to repeat the mistakes again. Dark energy. During my career, I worked with many distinguished groups, distinguished people, and I'm really, really happy and grateful for that. Throughout the world, different countries, different groups. But one project, one study, which I truly enjoyed, was the study of dark energy in a group at the Space Telescope Science Institute when I was there. So there, for 2 years, we looked for galaxies, for supernovae, and to constrain, to find the amount of dark energy in the universe. And eventually, we managed to find it. So here is how it works. So here in the horizontal axis, we have the time from present to the past. So when you look this way, from left to right, you look from present to the past. The vertical axis, don't worry about. Just believe what I say. So the lines are predictions from Einstein's theory of relativity. So depending on line, the yellow line is for a decelerating universe, is if the universe is decelerating, in other words, expansion of the universe is decelerating, the points we put here, comparing to observations, should follow the yellow line. This line, if the universe is accelerating, the points, observational points, should follow that. Now, for 2 years, we collected data and eventually put them on this graph. Now I put them back, and I want to show you which one of these lines, these points, observations, really follow. So we are going from present to the past, and then what we see, they follow neither. The universe is not constantly decelerating or constantly accelerating. But in the past, you see this line is parallel to this. In the past, the universe was decelerating due to the force of dark matter. And suddenly, at some point, the slope of the line changed and started to accelerate. Today, the universe is accelerating. We are in an accelerating universe. By accelerating, I mean the speed of galaxies increases as we go further away. So basically, the speed of galaxies increases with time. So today, we are living in an accelerating universe. The point where this change, the slope changed, corresponds to 4.2 billion years ago. So 4.2 billion years ago, the universe went through a phase transition from a decelerating to an accelerating universe, where we are living now. The day we found this, I could not sleep at night. I kept thinking that what is the possibility that after 2,500 years of civilization, today, during our lifetime, we could find this. And I was a part of the group that could find that. Studying the universe, the transition in the universe, and I repeat, it's observation, it's not theory. It's out there, it exists. And this was quite amazing, and the reason I could not sleep at the night. And this answers the question. Now, we have the dark energy, which is a repulsive force. So it's basically so that it's exactly opposite the dark matter. Repels galaxies, the mass, the matter in the universe. And dark matter, which is gravitating. Remember, gravity is like me. It is attractive. So we have the gravity which brings things together due to dark matter. And dark energy, basically repulsive, pushes things back. And since the amount of dark energy is more than dark matter, 73% dark energy, 23% dark matter, then dark energy dominates. Therefore, the universe is going to expand forever. The universe is open. And this is the question we could answer in our lifetime. And this is amazing. This is truly amazing that we lived in the time the technology was so that we could study this and we could use our brain to study that and find the future of the universe, the future destiny of our universe. There is one thing stronger than all the armies of the world. That is an idea whose time has come, Isaac Newton. And this is true about all the ideas in economics, in politics. Once the time of an idea comes, nothing could stop it. The universe evolves, and life is in the universe, and we know that life is because we are here. What is the origin of life? What forms the life in the universe? So we start from ourselves. What really constitutes our bodies is carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, iron, and all these elements. How did they form? All these were formed, these are heavy elements, were formed in stars. I told you hydrogen and helium were formed in the first 3 to 12 minutes after the Big Bang. After that, when the stars formed, the heavier elements were formed in stars by fusing lighter elements. Lighter elements came together and formed the heavier and heavier elements. And this is how the heavy elements were formed. And this is the structure of a star. A star like our sun. The heavier elements at the core, at the center, and the lighter elements go up to the surface of the star. The lightest, the hydrogen, then helium, carbon, neon, oxygen, and so on, until iron at the core, at the center. When the iron is formed, the process of formation of heavy elements stops. Because in order to fuse iron, you need more energy to put in than you get out. So iron, elements heavier than irons cannot be produced in stars. But nevertheless, all the elements we need for our life are produced in stars by fusion of lighter elements. For example, we have helium from the Big Bang. If you fuse 3 heliums together, you form a carbon. And then helium and carbon, neon. And helium and neon, oxygen, and so on and so forth. And these elements scatter in the universe after the star dies. Once the star dies, it explodes through supernova explosion. And that throws out all these heavy elements in the universe, in the interstellar medium. And eventually, they land on a planet like the Earth, which could support life. And here we are, the life. So everything and anything in our bodies, the phosphorus in your brain, the carbon in your body, the iron in your blood, all were formed in stars at some point and ended up on the Earth through supernova explosion. Through that explosion, the energy is so high, one of the most violent processes in the universe. The iron is converted to yet heavier elements. And this is how heavier elements, elements heavier than iron, were formed. And here you see the elements. So here you add helium to one of these and form the other one. Helium had 4, the number, as I told you, proton and neutron. The total number of protons and neutrons is 4. And these are all multiples of 4. So these are the most stable elements in the universe. Because helium-4 is the most stable. And once you add helium to other elements, these become more stable. This is why these elements exist in abundance in the universe. Carbon, oxygen, neon, magnesium, silicon, all the sands is silicon, iron, and so on and so forth. All are multiples of four. The elements between them are less stable and are formed by attracting single protons or neutrons. Now we come to our home planet, the Earth. The Earth was born 4.6 billion years ago. And soon after it was formed, it was hit by a Mars-sized object. And believe it or not, we are here because of that collision. That was a catastrophic collision, but had 3 major effects. One, it put the Earth in this orbit around the sun and fixed its speed around the sun. 2, it tilted the orbit of the Earth by 23.5 degrees. This is the reason for seasons. The reason for season is that the Earth orbit is tilted. It's not because sun gets closer to the Earth in the summer or further away in the winter. It's simply because the Earth orbit is tilted and sun shines more directly in one hemisphere compared to the other. This is why we get seasons. And this tilt was produced when that object about 4.3 billion years ago hit the Earth. And the third, a part of the Earth was separated and landed in the orbit around the Earth, and this is the moon. And by moon being there, it stabilizes the orbit of the Earth and other planets. And here we are stable on the Earth, living for 4.6 billion years. Throughout its history, the Earth went through a violent process of being hit by extraterrestrial objects. And as you can see here is the impact of all these coming and hitting the Earth. But at some point, it basically, there is no sort of collision from outer space to the Earth. This is when all the planets in the solar system got in the orbit they have today. And what happens is that once something comes to hit the Earth, they basically attract that because they are more massive than the Earth and basically work as a vacuum cleaner for the Earth, basically protecting the Earth from being collided by other objects. And this is the reason that we have not faced, for the last 65 million years at least, have not faced any catastrophic mass extinction. Life's tragedy is that we got too old too soon, but wise too late. Indeed, if we were wiser when we were younger, we would have done a lot more with our lives. Our colleagues and we have started to look for new planets, planets like the Earth. Planets which could harbor life. And the first planets were found a few years ago. And today, we have abundant evidence that there are lots and lots of planets like the Earth, the size of the Earth, and orbiting around their sun with the same distance as the Earth is around the sun. And if there is life on those, if there is life anywhere in the universe, it should be in those planets. And this is what we are starting to do, to study the atmosphere of these planets to see if they are biosignatures, any signature that is evidence for life in those planets. And that we are looking for that. This is absolutely exciting. A man who dares to waste 1 hour of time has not discovered the value of life, Charles Darwin. Indeed, that's what I keep telling to my students, that don't sleep. I mean, this is so exciting, so fascinating, and it really surprises me how could you sleep? It's just so much to learn, so much to find, and we have all the facilities to do that. A man who dares to waste 1 hour of time has not discovered the value of life. And where are we going to do? Where are we going in the future? The best thing about the future is that it comes one at a time, Abraham Lincoln. Indeed, it took us 1,700 years to remove the Earth from the center of the universe, put the sun in the center of the universe. And it took us, as I said, 100 years to go from here to there. And this shows what's going to happen over the next 100 years. So we have the shuttle, and shuttle goes up and repairs the Hubble Space Telescope. These two, I'm showing it deliberately, these are the two most complicated instruments ever built by the mankind, the Hubble Space Telescope and the Space Shuttle. And they meet 300 kilometers above the Earth. Spacewalk and they repair the Hubble. And here we are. We can see deep into the universe. This is amazing. We have ground-based telescopes. We, at the University of California, we have the Keck. And this is really, it is fantastic to be an astronomer at the University of California, because this belongs to the University of California and California Institute of Technology. And with that, this is a 10-meter telescope, and you could really see deep in the universe. I have, in fact, a student right now in Hawaii observing on these telescopes tonight. It's cloudy, actually. It's snowing, unfortunately, but we are doing it. We have to send people there to do it. And this is absolutely fantastic what we can do today. And then the future, there are satellites. Kepler is the satellite which looked for planets, extrasolar planets. And it found thousands of extrasolar planets, which we are studying now. We are doing follow-up observations with the Keck on those planets. Whatever you are, be a good one. Abraham Lincoln. is important because there is no tolerance for mistake. If any of these satellites, and I come and discuss it, something goes wrong, it goes to a wrong orbit, or it crashes, and everything is gone. And this is the James Webb Space Telescope, due to launch in 3 years. My colleagues are working on this, and it's basically ready to be tested and launched in 3 years' time. It's nine times more powerful than the Hubble Space Telescope. 6.5 meter is the diameter, and would be sent in an orbit beyond the moon, called Lagrangian 2 orbit, where the gravity of the Earth, the moon, and the sun cancel each other out. It's 1.5 million kilometers from the Earth. At that point, they unpack it and start to look deep into the universe. With that, we could really see significantly deeper into the universe and back in time, find even more distant galaxies and planets and study those. On the ground, we are designing the 30-meter telescope, TMT. That's, again, another telescope at the University of California. And in fact, the first light instrument on this telescope, I am at UCR, the instrument scientist for the first light instrument on this telescope, meaning that the first night when the doors are open and it gets light from outer space, the light comes on that instrument. So we are basically leading that instrument, investigation of that instrument. It's expected to go to Hawaii. I hope it will. It's the best site in the world. This is 30 meter diameter. It's 9 times more powerful than the Keck telescope. And with that, you could really, truly see deep in space. This and James Webb Space Telescope would revolutionize astronomy for the next generation. The only limit to our realization of tomorrow will be doubt of today. If we do not doubt today, we do not discover tomorrow. Any discovery needs doubting to begin with, needs wondering. We are living on this, the pale blue dot. This is the image of the Earth as seen from space. And when you look at it, it's really, and this is the Earth. If someone shows this to you and tells you there are 7 billion people are living on this, you do not believe. During the history of civilization, during the history, people have been killed and have killed for possession of a small part of this. As Carl Sagan nicely put it, everyone you ever knew, everyone you ever admired, everyone you ever read about, all the prophets, philosophers, scientists, at some point lived on this small dot. With this, we learn two things. One, how small we are. Two, how lonely we are. And we are indeed. Billions of miles around us is nothingness. And this is the only thing we have. The purpose of life is life with a purpose. And a life with no purpose is no life worth living. And the purpose here is to find about ourselves and our location, position, the humanity's position in the universe. This is what we are looking for. Now, here, I condensed the whole history of the universe in 1 year, just to put it in prospect. Suppose the Big Bang happened in 12 a.m., 1st of January. By early February, the Milky Way galaxy, our own galaxy, was formed. Early in September, the solar system came to place. And late in September, early evidence for life on Earth happened. That goes back to over 3 billion years ago. By mid-December, advanced life on Earth started to emerge. By December 26th, a day after Christmas Day, dinosaurs came to the scene. And by December 31st, 9 a.m., hominids, our early ancestors, were born. And December 31st, 25 seconds before the midnight, before the start of the new year, the agriculture was invented. That's about 10,000 years ago. And by 11 seconds before the midnight, the pyramids were built. This put all these in prospect. The entire human history took place during the last 4 minutes of the history of the universe. This is how young we are. Don't go around saying the world owes you a living. The world owes you nothing. It was here first. Now, the last few minutes of my speech, I want to pose the most fundamental question, the ultimate question. Who did all what happened? How did all happen? Who is responsible for what we see? And I set two questions for that. I give you an introduction for that. Everything in the universe is the result of the laws of physics. It's the laws of physics which build chemistry. So you have atoms, and atoms build molecules, and molecules is the science of chemistry. And biology comes from chemistry, and life comes from biology. I apologize to chemists, but that's the fact. Chemistry is a part of physics. I'm sorry, our dean is a chemist. Now, here is the question I pose, I repeat. Everything started from the laws of physics. Chemistry and biology started from physics. Now my question is this, which one came to be first, the universe or the laws of physics? If the laws of physics came to be first, then the universe must have been created based on some laws. So creation of the universe must have been deterministic. So it wasn't chaotic. So there was laws before the universe started. Based on those laws, the universe started. So everything was deterministic. So the universe was created based on some rules. In this case, one day we may know how the universe started, but we would never know how laws of physics came to be. If the reverse is true, if the universe came first and laws of physics were invented in the universe, came into the universe, then the creation of the universe must have been chaotic, based on no laws, because there was no physics before that. So it must have been just spontaneous, coming from somewhere. In this case, one day, we may know how the laws of physics are and where they come from, but we would never ever know how the universe started. This is stretching human imagination to the limit. The second question, why is the universe the way it is? The simple answer is because we are here. If we were not here, would the universe have been the same? We don't know. So the universe, as we know it, is the joint product of the observer and the observed. If you remove the observer from the universe, there is no one to observe what is observed. So you don't know what is out there. And if you remove the observed, the observer has nothing to observe. So this is you need the joint, both observer and the observed. And the reason that the universe is like this is simply because we are here. Because if it was any other form, we would not have been here. Everything has gone the right way, or maybe the wrong way, for us to be here today. And this is entropic principle. The universe is like this because we are here. We can easily forgive a child who is afraid of the dark. The real tragedy of life is when men are afraid of the light, Plato. We can easily forgive a child who is afraid of the dark. The real tragedy of life is when men are afraid of the light. 2,500 years ago, Plato. Thank you.
Thank you, Barham, for a really inspired talk. We have time for questions. And so the way that works is that so everyone can be heard, there are two microphones on either side near the front. And so I hope that you will move down there and ask your questions. And I think while people are getting into position to do that, I'm going to start with one, and I'm going to ask you, Barham, what you think the next great question in cosmology is, and what's going to be needed to answer that.
A lot of questions. We are really in the golden age of cosmology. It's nature of dark energy. What is dark energy? How it makes the universe to accelerate. The nature of the most distant objects, galaxies in the universe. the first stars, what's the property of the first stars formed in the universe, and how they affected the future evolution of the universe. So basically, in every angle you look at, there is a new question which we are addressing. And as a cosmologist, as an astronomer, there is not one single week passing by without me learning something new about the universe, about stars, about galaxies. This is the speed with which we are moving.
That's great. Let's go ahead and start, and we'll start over here on my left. No. Just move a little closer if you would, please.
So thank you for the lovely talk. I had a question about, you mentioned there's a lot of leftover hydrogen in the universe. What form does that take that's not in stars?
What form it takes for hydrogen?
Yeah.
It's because it's cold out there, it's mostly molecular hydrogen existing. So it's not ionized because it needs high energy particles.
My question actually sort of is it in like a uniform blanket, or is it organized some way?
Well, it's a good question. It's clumpy. The answer is not clear. We don't know how the distribution of hydrogen is. For example, at the very early universe, when the first generation of stars and galaxies were formed, it's expected that it would be clumpy, because those clumps could form stars and galaxies. You need density and homogeneities to form stars and galaxies.
Thank you.
Let's move to the next one, and we have some young people over here, and I want to make sure that we get a chance. So over here.
My question has to do with synthetic elements. What new synthetic elements would you expect on these new galaxies, new planets that you expect in the future?
Synthetic elements?
Yes.
By synthetic elements, you mean elements not being on the periodic table? Or, sorry, what do you mean by synthetic elements?
Brand new. Obviously, brand new synthetic elements are being proposed.
Yeah. So
what would you expect on these other places?
I don't know. And I don't think we know, because we have to look for signatures of the elements as we know them. So before you look for them, you should know what to look for. For synthetic elements which may not exist on the Earth, we don't know what they are, so we don't know what to look for. But this doesn't mean they do not exist. It's just, the question is just like life. We only have one form of life, and anywhere in the universe we look for life, we just expect something like this. But it doesn't mean other forms do not exist.
Over here.
Thank you for the talk. I was wondering if we could have your take on the James Webb Space Telescope. What you mean by it being more powerful than the Hubble Space Telescope, and what you as an astronomer will be looking for with that telescope?
So when the mirror of the telescope is big, the light collecting area would be big. And this area of a circle, the mirror, is proportional to the square of the radius. So a 6.5-meter telescope, Hubble is about 2.4-meter. So from that ratio, you could see that it's about nearly 9 times more powerful than the Hubble. It's simply because the size of the mirror of the telescope. The same for 30-meter telescope. So the diameter is 30 meter. So bigger the mirror, more light collecting surface, and hence you could look deeper, fainter.
So will you just be kind of like the Hubble Space Telescope, looking at dark parts of the sky and just see what you find, or?
I'm sorry, what, Hubble Space Telescope what?
Like how for the Hubble Space Telescope, you looked at the darkest part of the sky and got the deep field.
Well, darkest part of the sky, they are not empty, as we found from Hubble Ultra Deep Field. If you look at that area, you see nothing, nothingness with the naked eye. But once you start collecting light for 400 hours with the Hubble, then galaxies start to emerge. And this is what you see. So any dark part of the sky you look at, there are billions and billions of galaxies there. But they're too distant to be seen, so you need large telescopes to see them.
I want to take a couple of the questions over here, and I also will take this opportunity to point out that there will be opportunity at the end of the panel discussion for people to move down and continue with questions, but please.
Since you had said that there could have been other universes before ours, and that they might have just collapsed itself, do you think that there could be other universes other than our own?
Could we see any, could there any parallel universes exist at the same time with ours? So if they do, there's no way we could know it. So just thinking about that is abstract. And here is the reason. So the fastest speed we know is the speed of light. The longest time we know, what is the longest time? Is the age of the universe. So if you multiply the fastest speed, c, speed of light, by the longest time, t, the age of the universe, you get a distance. This is the longest distance you could ever be able to see. This is the horizon distance. Anything beyond that distance, you would never ever be able to see. If those universes exist, those would be beyond the horizon distance, meaning that we would never be able to get any signal from them. So we would never be able to know if they exist or not.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead.
If universes are constantly expanding into something, is the thing that they're expanding into, was it pre-made specifically for the universe to expand into?
Right, that's the question people keep asking on the plane when they realize you're astronomers. So what happens is that the space is being created as the universe expands. So the space is created as the universe expands. So it basically expands into a new space as it's formed.
Thank you.
And in other words, the edge of the observable universe, when you look that far out, you basically look close to the Big Bang, because you look back in time. So that, look at it that way.
Thank you.
What great questions. And so if that wasn't enough, what we're gonna do now is move into the panel phase. And if the panelists would please come on up. And what I will do first, just to give you a little bit of the ground rules, I'll introduce each of the panelists. And then I'll try and set the stage with just a little bit of background, a little bit of context, and then a question. And then I will let them all wax philosophically or artistically or whatever they choose to do about some of these very, very heady questions. And at the end of that, we're going to open it up to questions from the audience to try and make this a bit of a conversation between us and you. And then as people need to leave, that's fine, but we'll continue things and you can move towards the front beyond that. So it's really been a huge pleasure for me to be able to be part of this. And part of that has involved learning some new people on campus, meeting some new people on campus, and learning some very different perspectives about the kinds of things that I do and that I care about. And so part of what this panel is seeking to do is get some different perspectives, different than mine and different than Barham's. And so let me go ahead and introduce these panelists, and what an interesting and esteemed group it is. To my immediate right is Eric Switzgable, and I'm going to put my glasses on. Eric is a professor of philosophy here at UC Riverside. He's a philosopher who explores the connections between empirical psychology and philosophy of mind, especially the nature of belief, the inaccuracy of our judgments about our stream of conscious experience, and the tenuous relationship between philosophical ethics and actual moral behavior. I told you it was going to be a bit different. to his right, and my right also, Dana Simmons, who is an associate professor of history at UC Riverside. Professor Simmons is a historian of science and technology whose research interests include hunger, nutrition, soil and plant science, political economy, the human sciences, feminist theory, architecture, modern Europe, technopolitics, and technoscientific utopias. She is also a faculty co-advisor of the UCR Science Studies Group, but clearly what she is not is someone who sleeps a lot. to her right, we're very honored to have Jose Funes, who is a member of the faculty of the Catholic University of Cordoba in Argentina. Father Funes is an Argentine Jesuit priest, an astrophysicist in the field of extragalactic astronomy, and a former director of the Vatican Observatory. How many of you knew that the Vatican had an observatory? Not many hands. We'll hear more about that. He is currently working on a multidisciplinary project related to the search for inhabited worlds as part of a sabbatical at the Jesuit School of Theology in Berkeley, and I think just about to head back to Argentina. And then we have Nalo Hopkinson, who is a professor of creative writing at USU Riverside. She is a Jamaican-born Canadian and a science fiction writer, whose novels and short stories often draw on Caribbean history, language, and storytelling traditions. Her novel, Midnight Robber, is set in the far future, where interplanetary and alternate dimension travel is possible. And then Barham to the far right. So one of the challenges that I was faced with was trying to find the thread in all of that, and to try and center it around the overarching theme of this lecture series, which is, Are We Alone? And I'll give you just a little bit of background, and then I'm going to turn it over to them. 2 days ago, I was sitting across the table from the astronaut, the Hubble scientist, who repaired the space shuttle astronaut who repaired the Hubble telescope, John Grunsfeld. And our discussions were centered on designing telescopes that would allow us to search beyond our solar system for life on extrasolar planets. And so in a couple of the lectures during this series, we'll be hearing about the abundance of these planets and the possibilities of life. And much of what drives me is the study of the early Earth as a template, if you will, an analog to develop atmospheric models that we can then explore on these myriad possible planets beyond our solar system. And so that's how I ended up making the mistake of 3 billion rather than 13 billion. My world sort of ends at 4.5 billion years ago, at least in an Earth-centric sense, but now I'm expanding my horizons. And so for me, one of the great discoveries within my research group and our colleagues would be a convincing measurement of oxygen on an extrasolar planet, perhaps a few light years away, that we can unequivocally tie to biology, to photosynthesis. So for me, it's not about intelligent life. That would be wonderful, but that's not really how our missions or my templates are designed. And it occurred to me that my view of whether we're alone and why I should care and how that question intersects with both my personal and professional life is really different than how my colleagues feel. And so what we're going to do now is let them wax, as I said, according to their disciplines, about these very fundamental questions. And we'll start with Eric.
Okay, thanks. And thanks for the wonderful talk. And lots of philosophy at the end, and I have lots of things I could say, but I'm just going to focus on one thing, which is the emphasis on microbial life, which is, I guess, NASA's emphasis recently as opposed to looking for intelligent life. And I guess it's likely that we will find evidence of microbial life, according to people I've spoken to, at some point in the near future. So let's suppose that we find that. So we find evidence that there are tiny microorganisms out there. And I guess one question I like to ask is, how excited should we be about that? So here's the question, are we alone? Written in big letters above us. What does it mean to be alone? Think of Robinson Crusoe. He was stranded on an island all by himself, so he thought anyway. He's kind of our paradigm example of somebody who's totally alone, but of course, he was surrounded by life, by trees, by fish, by worms, bacteria on his face even. This suggests, I think, one way of understanding what it is to be alone, on which a person can be totally alone despite being surrounded by life. And on that understanding, if we discover microbes on another planet, it does not follow that we are not alone, right? To be not alone, in the sense I'm thinking of, means having some sort of companion, someone who will recognize you, someone to interact with, intelligent life, not just microbial life, or at least a dog. I think Nalo brought up that point at lunch. Now, you could be excited to find life just because, hey, wow, it's life. But what's so exciting about life per se? I mean, what is life such that microbes can have it? It's things like maintaining homeostasis, having some sort of stable organization, drawing energy from the environment to maintain that homeostatic organization, reproducing, being complex in a certain way. All that's cool. The Great Red Spot on Jupiter, which is a giant weather pattern, has maintained homeostasis, or a stable organization, for a long period of time. Flames that jump from treetop to treetop reproduce themselves in a certain sense. Galaxies are complex, so homeostasis, reproduction, complexity, they're all cool. They're already out there. Tie them up in a package of microbial life, maybe that's even cooler. But in a way, we already know already, even without discovering microbes, that all that stuff is out there in the universe. Now suppose instead of finding life, we found a robot. An intelligent social robot like C-3PO from Star Wars, or Data from Star Trek, right? These would not be alive by standard biological definitions, right? For example, they don't have reproductive organs. Finding life would be cool, but finding C-3PO would be a better cure for loneliness. That's it.
Okay. I'll withhold my comments, and others will as well, but we will all have a chance at the end. Dana.
Well, thank you. It's such an honor to be, and so exciting to be part of this panel. So I was asked, what does this mean to me personally and professionally? And I'm trying to tie those together. We are a huge biogeochemical accident. People in my field of study have a kind of common motto. That is, things could be otherwise. Historians are interested what gets us out of bed, what drives us and keeps us searching, is the question of how things might have turned out differently. There are always multiple possibilities that are fixing and unfixing themselves. So this is true for forms of life, and it's true for our life on Earth. We could have turned out otherwise. So I'm thinking, why, you know, how might we react to the news if we find news that we are not alone? I thought back to when Europeans encountered indigenous peoples of other continents. Some sought to colonize them or use them to profit from them. Some sought to convert them to European ways of living. And some, very few relatively, sought to learn from them, learning other ways of living and knowing. And I hope that we might do the same as we look out from our pale blue dot. So that's part of why I'm interested in life on Earth, is how people react. And I think this question is on the minds of planetary scientists as they look out. Indeed, certainly it was on the mind of Carl Sagan, who hoped that contact with the immensity of the universe and other life forms would make humans honor and value each other more. And certainly, this amazing biogeochemical accident is what makes history more precious to me.
Jose.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to thank the organizers for having me tonight. And I would like to address two questions. The first is the $500,000 question, and it's why the Vatican is interested in astronomy. And the short answer is, I don't know. I was asked to tell a little bit of the Vatican Observatory in 1 minute. Baran did a wonderful job summarizing the history of the universe in 14 billion years in 50 minutes. I will try to say a little bit about the Vatican Observatory in 1 minute. Somehow the origin of the Vatican Observatory related to the Galileo's case. But basically, the Vatican Observatory is an institute of research in astrophysics as any other institute in the world. So our colleagues are astronomers. And because astrobiology is an important discipline, a frontier in astrophysics and biology, for physics, chemistry, geology, the Vatican Observatory considered that this important. For that reason, in 2005, the observatory organized a summer school for grad students on astrobiology. And Dr. Mario De Leo Winkler is here. He was one of the students of that school. And in 2009, I organized a conference at the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, which is the right venue for this kind multidisciplinary approach to life in the universe. Then, you know, as E.T. was homesick, I was also homesick. And I went back to Argentina. And I wanted to address the $1 million question. Are we alone in the universe? And you know, there used to be a TV show, The Millionaire, I guess it was called, and you have the chance to call a friend. Well, I did. I called my friends. And in Cordoba, I organized a group of research to address this question. Are we alone in the universe? It's a multidisciplinary group. We are about 15 people. There are astronomers, an architect, an engineer, philosophers. I have studied philosophy and theology too. And we call other. I know that there are many maybe Spanish speakers here. So, you know, to exist, you need an acronym and a logo. We have an acronym. It's other. Other for other worlds, Earth, Tierra, Earth, H, humanity, E, espacio, space, and R, remote. And we call ourselves a laboratory of new ideas. We try to have new ideas to address this old question. Are we alone? And basically, I'm interested also in the significance that there might be if we find somewhere E.T. Thank you.
Thank you to the organizers for inviting me. As a science fiction writer, I don't often expect to be on a panel with people who are scientists. You guys do the research that I then try to understand so I can write what I do. There's two things that have been occurring to me, and one is the answer to the question of are we alone, it depends on who you think of as we. Because we aren't. We are, as a species, social. We have both this need and this fear to look out and see something looking back at us. And we can get that from friends, from family, from the dog, from, you know, a whale in an aquarium. Right here on Earth, we are not alone. What it means to look out further and try to discover where we are, I'm hearing that one of the concerns is if what we discover, what seems most likely is that we might find an oxygen trace related to photosynthesis of a microbe that may have gone extinct millennia ago, and is the public going to get excited about that? Is that something that we can sort of energize people to give us funding for? Well, that's part of the reason I think science fiction works for me. The young lady asked the question about what is the universe expanding into? And the answer kind of messes with your head. But I have a paradigm for that. I'm old enough to remember Wile E. Coyote in the cartoons building a staircase so that he can climb up it. So he's laying down the stairs as he goes. For me, that becomes the paradigm of how to understand the fact that the universe is building its own space to expand into as it's expanding. I think that science, like so much else in the world, creates stories and creates things that ignite our imaginations. And that if we ignite people's imaginations, it doesn't matter so much if we understand that what we're going to find, we'll understand the significance of it. As people, we have already told the story of why water is important. We know that water is life. So finding that there may have been water on Mars gets us excited. So I think we don't need to worry so much about what kind of PR job we're doing We just need to tell the stories that get us excited, and that excitement will catch on and will give paradigms, people paradigms for how to understand what it is we're trying to do.
Thank you. Barham, do you want to say something specifically about this? You've held court for a long time, but...
I spoke enough, so I could take another turn.
Well, you know, one of the things that struck me is, Nalo, you were saying that one of your not challenges, but one of your goals is to understand the science that that we're all doing. And it seems to me that a big part of what we're trying to do as scientists is discover that world that was only in the imagination of good writers like you. And so we had this conversation about what happens to science fiction when it becomes science fact. And so this ever-expanding horizon of imagining something more than we know now. And so for me, I had that epiphanal moment with exoplanets. That's just my personal bias. And I love Mars, and I love water worlds, the icy moons around our solar system planets. But the discoveries that you'll be hearing about in the subsequent weeks are astounding. We have over 4,000 confirmed planets outside of our solar system. And this is based on a very limited set of observations of something like 150,000 stars using the Kepler telescope within our galaxy. And when you extrapolate that, just within our galaxy, it starts to become hundreds of millions or more. And when you multiply that by the number of galaxies within the universe, well, it seems almost limitless, right? And so there's an extraordinary amount of good fortune that has to come together to create life and to sustain life. We need liquid water. We need, and I'll talk about this in January, the combination of factors that have to come and sustain to a planet. And so the oxygen is exciting to me because it means that this great experiment that the Earth has done has happened somewhere else. And then when I multiply that by the billions of other planets, if not more, within the universe, it's staggering to imagine how that experiment has played out in different ways. And so we search for life as we know it, but we're always challenging ourselves, say in a science fiction way, but informed by physics, biology, chemistry. We think about the kinds of life that we never imagined before, other life forms, other structures of organisms. And I have to say, I particularly enjoy talking to Eric because I would describe it on some level sort of sparring and just the best possible way to get at this heart of why we care. There's one universal, really, I think, in science in America and throughout the world, is that almost everyone cares about what NASA and the European equivalents and Chinese equivalents and throughout the world. And so what I would like to have happen now is for brave people to walk down to the microphone and to start asking questions and also sharing your views on whether you care, why you care, whether you would like for NASA to continue and other agencies to continue in this great exploration, and why. I see a brave soul right there. Go for it.
How did dark matter or dark energy get in the universe?
The beginning of the beginning.
Yeah, that's the answer. It's a good question. Always you get difficult questions from you guys. So I don't know. I don't know the answer. So we know partly how dark matter might have produced. Maybe it's... dead stars, for example, black holes, these could constitute part of dark matter or massive particles that we could explain. It has been a part of the universe. It's just never managed to emit light. So that's about dark matter. How dark energy did, we don't know. Because what we see is just the evidence for dark energy. But it's we don't know its nature.
Let's go over here.
Okay, I have a question. What sort of activation energy could have happened that caused the Big Bang to happen?
So it's the The answer is not clear and it's very abstract, it's theoretical, but it's likely it was the lowest state of energy. And at the lowest state of energy, you could produce particles, you could produce energy. And that is what happened. So it's called vacuum. And once it starts to form particles, it's a fluctuation happens in that vacuum. So that's basically believed to be the cause of the Big Bang.
Over here.
I'm currently reading a book called I Contain Multitudes, about microorganisms. And one of the things that the author states is that for billions of years on the Earth, very simple microorganisms existed. And then there was a time, and he states that it was only this one time that it happened, and it's never happened since, that eukaryotes were formed, which then formed who we are, basically. So, you know, it just made me start thinking about out in the universe, you know, we think of, you know, well, there's, you know, microorganisms that may be out there. But when I think of the 4.5 billion years that the planet has been here, and then we've had this one instant, then what's the chances of there being intelligent life out in the universe?
That's a great question. It goes back to this idea, if you ran the tape again, would you end up in the same place? Would one of the panelists field this? Yeah.
Maybe I can say, I'm not a biologist, but what I've been reading is that, as we have seen in the presentation, it took around almost 12, 13 year, million, billion years to form life as we know it right now. So it's a very, the emergence of life is a very complex process. And my understanding is as far as the process becomes more complex, rarer are the possibilities that we are going to find intelligent life. This is my guess. We would be, I guess, disappointed if we find something like a dog. I love dogs, so nothing against dogs. But our expectations, I would say, is to find someone to whom we can talk. Someone that, as Homo sapiens, is able to do science, to ask questions about the Big Bang, the origin of life. We would expect to find someone that is able to write science fiction. We expect someone who we could communicate in some kind of language, maybe it's in universal language, maybe to whom, I mean, we can communicate maybe with music, someone that is able to compose music, and why not? Someone who is able to believe in God too, that is a spiritual being in that sense, that spirituality is part of the process of the emerging of life. We have some kind of awareness of in the universe. We can think the universe. The universe is within us. We are part of the universe. So I would say that could be what, when we ask the question, are we alone? We are hoping to, I don't know if we're going to meet ET with these qualities, but this is what I would expect.
Yes, of course.
Something?
Yes.
About this kind of origin story, when we think about who we are and where we come from, to think that we come from rocks and we come from bacteria and we owe our existence to rocks. I think, just a gesture back to Eric's point, you know, that we're rocks are our kin, and we can be just as excited about living among lots of floating rocks as we can be about finding E.T.
Wow. Well, we know there are a lot of rocks. We know that already.
One thing is that, as I said, there are, and this is observed fact, 100,000 million galaxies in the observable universe. And in each galaxy, on average, 100,000 million stars. Around some of those stars might be planets, and on some of them might be life. It's 10 to 22 stars in the observable universe, and this is only 4% of the universe. So statistically, it might be possible to have life somewhere, as you see it from the numbers. But then again, the probability of all these coming together to form life as we know it is as low. And my colleagues know better than I do. But we just hear because of some, you could call it coincidence, of biology and geoscience and chemistry. What's the chances of this happening somewhere else? The other problem is that we only know of one life. So we only have one data point. So wherever we look for is just something like this, and this would bias our search for life again. So it really boils down to what we mean by life, and so that's my view.
So I'm of the school that thinks that the likelihood of life being created in other worlds is high. Well, I will freely admit, in the community that works on this, the true origins of life question. There are many different theories on that, and we've made major advances. It is about hot water and rocks and the interactions of abiotic components on the ocean floor, or perhaps somewhere else, that come together to give us these building blocks and give us the simplest organisms. And on Earth, we think that may have happened over 4 billion years ago. So I don't struggle with that. I think the question really for me is, how does that play out from there? And how do you sustain life? And so let me just ask a question, as many of you wouldn't be here if you weren't interested in this research broadly. And so, exciting results from Mars. Extraordinary results. And the 2020 rover is going up, and we'll have the deputy chief scientist from the 2020 rover mission here as part of this lecture series. And so one of the big discoveries that has already come out from Curiosity and research before that is that there clearly were large oceans on Mars. Some estimates 20% of the Mars surface may have been covered by liquid oceans. Liquid oceans, liquid water, is really sort of the gold standard in the search for life. As we understand life, it requires liquid water. That may be wrong, but the habitable zones for exoplanets are defined by the temperature relationships that would sustain liquid water. How many of you were excited when liquid water was described from Mars convincingly? How many of you would be excited if a methane measurement was with the 2020 rover, or I'll tell you, I have the inside scoop from the meeting I was just at, that there are plans for sample recovery in the 2020s by NASA. There are plans for humans to be orbiting Mars within the early part of the 2030s. And if things go on schedule, for humans to land on Mars in the late 2030s. So that opens up incredible possibilities about recovering samples. And I can tell you right now, they're not going to be footprints. I'm not being facetious, but they're not going to be little green anything other than perhaps microbes. And so we might get a methane measurement that we can be convinced derived from microbes, from organisms. How many think that would be exciting? That's a lot of hands. It may be a microbial mat. And so I think we all feel this idea of whatever it is, we'd like to know that it's out there. And then it opens up this sea of possibilities that there could be more and more and different. And so,
can I jump in on this?
Please.
Here's one reason that I hope we don't find life.
Oh.
So if it turns out that there's life near us, then that increases, in my mind, the likelihood that life arises commonly
right.
in the galaxy and the universe. And then there's a question arises, okay, if it arises commonly, how come we haven't had connections or how come we haven't had contact with any intelligent beings? And one of the more plausible explanations for that is that life really occurs very rarely, and mm-hmm. that's why we haven't had contact, right? But if we undercut that, then that increases the relative likelihood of another possibility, which is that once intelligent life occurs or technological life occurs, it tends to destroy itself.
Right.
Right. So if we find even microbial life nearby, then that should incline us, I think, all else being equal, to increase our confidence in the general thesis that intelligent life tends to destroy itself before it can contact other intelligent life. So that would be one reason to hope we don't find it.
Well, we have 4 billion years of evolution of life, and life was very different. Human and human-like organisms have only been around for a few million years, and it will change. And so the question is, when will that change? And a big part of the answer of that is how good custodians of the Earth we are, how much we protect our own home, and bet against the sorts of things that you're proposing.
The Earth has faced many mass extinctions during its 4.6 billion years.
Yep.
And after each mass extinction, life started to form and create itself and develop itself.
Well, it didn't start, it persisted, so, right?
Yeah.
Extinction that so wiped out 90% of life.
Right.
And yet
so
it thrived.
So it is resilient.
After.
So 95% of species were destroyed in many of these mass extinctions, but life did not.
So if you care a lot about life, then that's nice, right? But if you care about us and intelligent life, that's less encouraging, right?
It's hard to make that separation, I think, right? We live together.
Right, so if you say, well, look, if we destroy ourselves, if there's a mass extinction in 10 years, that's cool because there will still be microorganisms on Earth, right? So life will still go on, right? But I'd be like, no, that's not the kind of life that I care about most.
It won't be around.
And cockroaches will own the world. And I mean, to go back to the question of you asked people if finding methane traces would be as exciting. And I sort of feel that if you feel lonely and you're looking for company and you're looking for evidence that there might be company out there,
right.
A fart is as exciting as a footprint.
I used the word fart in our private conversations, but thank you for bringing it to that level. One of the things that's important to think about also is the exchange of life amongst planets through impacts. And so I just heard the argument that discovery of life on Mars would be phenomenal, but there's a good chance, a reasonable chance, that it would have come from Earth. And so the community of workers that focus on the icy moons, the water worlds surrounding Jupiter and Saturn in particular, they make the case, and it's always a funding argument at the end of the day, but they make the case that based on the models of how impact ejecta would transmit through the atmosphere or through the solar system, that would almost certainly represent a de novo, an original step in life on that planet rather than being seeded by the Earth. And so they say that's what we should really care about. It's not just that it maybe went to Mars and lived during that watery phase of Mars. But it came from us. What I really want to know is if that tape can play out and create life somewhere else. So we have people standing up here, and please.
Okay, this is for as someone who's religious, do you fear that the question, are we alone, contradicts religious teachings?
Could you please repeat the question?
As someone who's like religious, do you fear like the question, are we alone, contradicts religious teachings?
The question was, from a gentleman here who is religious,
okay.
is asking if there's a conflict.
I yep. got it now. There is no requirement for, I'm talking basically from the Catholic perspective of view. There is science fiction and there is theology fiction, in the sense that until we don't have any proof of life out there, Until now, we don't have any proof. So the thing we need to do is to be patient and to wait for the first organism that we find on Mars or in moons, Jovian moons, whatever in the space. This is the first word on this, or the final, it depends how you count, it shouldn't come from religion, but from science. Then there is no requirement for, I would say, Christian faith, that there is life, that we live in a bio-friendly universe, or that we are the only species in the universe. If there is a species out there, an intelligent one, as I was referring before, let's call it ET. Once I gave an interview to the Vatican newspaper, and I said, dealing with journalists, sometimes you have to provide them with a good headline before they put So I said, it is my brother. It is my brother and my sister. So if there is any ET alien species there, I would say that it's also a creature of God. There is much to speculate about this, and I don't want to be too long in my answer, but there's, if we are doing some kind of science fiction, there are different models of encounters with ET. One model is the 1492, when the Europeans met the Native Americans. But the other, and this is, I like to compare with movies. This is a kind of Avatar movie model. I also think there is a chance there to have a kind of District 9 model. And we may be dealing with a different civilization. We even could be dealing with refugees from other worlds, people that they have not survived their own civilization, that they are destroying themselves. And we may be dealing with other species asking for, or communicating their good experience, or asking for refuge. I don't want to be political, but are we going to build walls, or are we going to welcome them? I think that's the cosmic dilemma. It's a constant dilemma in human history, but I think it's also a constant dilemma in cosmic history.
Thank you.
What we want to do, while there's still quite a few of you here, is do the raffle, because there are swell prizes. And then we'll continue this discussion. And I, those of you lined up, just hold for one for a few minutes, if you would. Woman over here in the red, you've been very patient.
Yeah, to the gentleman from the Vatican, aren't there moral imperatives, and isn't pride a sin? I think in the time frame from 1903, just think how many intelligent forms of life we've lost here, like the Carolina parakeet or the passenger pigeon, and the ecumenical patriarch Bartholomew, the one that's the Eastern Church, that leads the Eastern Church, he said to cause species to become extinct is a sin. And we're also the water, the way we're paving over everything with freeways and parking lots, the water can't do its natural cycle. So it seems like it's hubris, it's the sin of pride that we're intelligent life forms here, and we seem to distance lens enchantment. If it's galaxies light years away, it's precious, but if it's here, it's like the California birds are either dying off or they're moving.
Let me interrupt, and I think I can paraphrase this and say, are we intelligent life?
This is a very good question. I am not too optimist in the sense that we could arrive to Mars in a few decades. And there is no other place where we can go. This is the only, as Pope Francis would say, this is our common home. And if we don't take care
of this home, we don't have any other places in the solar system to go. It's an imperative, I would say. It's a, not only a sin, because we have to take care of our Earth, our common home. We need to think in the future generations, not just on ourselves. So I think it's a very important, not only to think in ET or how to colonize Mars, or because that would be very difficult. It's very difficult to travel. We have seen in the lecture the distances in the universe. So I think it's very important to take care of our home. And this is not only for Christians or Catholics. This is a responsibility for every human being, not just for, even here, a dialogue with those who believe in God and those who don't believe in God is urgent, I would say. Thank you.
If I could just add a historical note.
Tap it once.
Sorry. Just on a historical note, that when scientists really started to worry systematically about whether intelligent life existed elsewhere, coincided historically with, and many of the same people were involved in building the nuclear bomb. Many of the same scientists who helped to build the nuclear bomb during the Second World War went on to be among those who were concerned with this issue. And it's not a coincidence, I think.
I would just add, and these are always just personal opinions, but as excited as I am about all the steps of exploration, the one that least excites me is the idea of colonization, and in particular, the idea of terraforming, about converting Mars to something more Earth-like, and that could be done. We modified our own atmosphere, we could modify someone else's atmosphere. And so I'll tell you that the NASA exploration driver is not that. And it's the opposite extreme. One of the biggest impediments to exploration of Mars is planetary protection. This extraordinary desire to not bring who we are to another planet and change their world. And so these wonderful discussions that happen in these different NASA panels, many of them focus on how can we go to the best places for life but not contaminate them. And it's really a conundrum. And so that's such a far extreme from the idea of making Mars like us. And you are right that Mars is really the only option. It really is.
There you go. Brings up a question that I've wondered, and is that are we able or prepared to recognize alien life? I mean, if intelligent alien life, I mean, I'm fairly sure we can recognize non-sentient alien life, but we have so much trouble determining what intelligence is that I'm not sure if we find it, if we'll recognize
that it. We'll know it. Yeah. That we'll know it, right? Yeah. I'm agreeing with you. Yeah. Barham?
I find the whole question rather complicated because, again, we are assuming the life there to be like the life we
Absolutely.
Lead every day. And it could be different. It could be silicon-based. I don't know. It just could be another chemical producing that life. And then again, the way we look at them, because we have the boundary conditions within our own planet. We use those to look for life in other planets. So by definition, we only find life which is similar to ours. For intelligent life, for example, we look for, correct me, Tim, if I'm wrong, for gases which are produced by industrial sort of processing. But this is...
Radio signals, there are a number of different techniques.
But this is what we have on our planet. They might be more advanced or less advanced or have other things that we, even if we look at it, we don't know what to look for. That's what I'm trying to say. So it gets very complicated.
It does, but I think, you know, it's sort of a conversation stopper to say that we don't know what that life will be, so
sure.
Why are we bothering to look for it? And so I think we have to be informed by what we know.
Yeah.
And then in parallel, there's extensive research exploring these alternatives. And I think, you know, in a way, Eric, it kind of gets to your notion of credence that I've taken such an attraction for, this idea of things that aren't knowable, but the probability of that unknowable thing becomes stronger, if that makes sense, as you inform it by science. Will you speak about that just a little bit?
Sure. So one of the things that I was struck by in one of our earlier conversations was that, you know, so like Barham was saying in his talk, well, you know, you can only see this far, so you really can't know anything about that. You can't know, for example, what caused the Big Bang. You can't know what's beyond, 13.7 billion light years out. And it seemed to me like there, like one way of thinking about things is, well, look, there's stuff on which we have hard scientific evidence, and there's other stuff we really know nothing about, and you kind of have to either just stay completely ignorant or turn to faith of some sort. And I guess I'm interested in, as a philosopher, I'm interested in thinking about that space where you can have guesses about things that, and philosophers talk about credences, like how likely do you think something is, how relatively unlikely do you think something is. You can adjust those credences or guesses based upon evidence, even if you don't have decisive evidence, right? So when we were talking about the likelihood of finding intelligent life, where I was mentioning just before, a little earlier in this conversation, the likelihood of our destroying ourselves in the future, we don't have hard scientific evidence on the likelihood of our destroying ourselves in the future, but one sort of scientific evidence that might be indirect that's pertinent to that is some way of trying to assess how likely is it in general that intelligent life forms destroy themselves, right? And perhaps, as I was suggesting before, if microbial life is common to find, then that should increase a little bit our credence in life being abundant, and then contingent upon that, increase our credence that abundant life that reaches intelligence destroys itself or something like that. So I guess one of the things that I guess I would hope for from conversations like this between humanists and people in the sciences is a kind of sense of those boundaries of things where you don't have hard scientific evidence where you can say this is definitely what happened, but you can bring to bear the tools of the humanities, the tools of the arts, to think in some reasonable way about what's a reasonable guess to make about how things stand on some of those big picture questions that we really care about.
Well put. Let's take a question over here.
How Eric was talking about microbials and their presence and kind of the implications if we find that, I was thinking it would be kind of interesting if we could almost sequence the DNA of it, if it even is built upon DNA. Then also from there, if we could almost run basic units of life through maybe a computer simulation and take in different variables of that and how different life will evolve throughout these kind of mass simulations. And I know it's kind of a futuristic idea, and it's kind of hard to deliver in that sense, but kind of just more of an idea and your guys' thoughts about that.
He asked you.
Well, I'm interested in simulation, right? So I actually wrote two separate comments, and I chose to present one of them rather than the other.
Talk a little bit about the simulation hypothesis.
But the simulation hypothesis was something else that I have been thinking about a bit. So the other set of comments that I've been thinking about giving had been about a different way in which the universe might have originated, which is that someone designed a computer program. And they put simulated agents inside that computer program, and those simulated agents are us. So this is sometimes called the simulation hypothesis in philosophy, and we already talked about Elon Musk.
Or the matrix, as I like to call it.
Or the matrix, yeah. People know that. That's not exactly the simulation hypothesis, but it's closely related. Yeah. Um, So, and we already mentioned Elon Musk. Elon Musk recently said that he thinks it's very likely that we are all artificial intelligences living inside a giant computer simulation.
Does that make it real?
So, Tesla, and he seems like, you know, a well-informed guy, you know, he's got a lot of money, so he's probably, most of what he says is true.
Ah, I see.
No, so I mean, so one of the things that I think, so I'm going to work back a little bit to artificial life in a minute, but one of the things that I think that's striking to me about people's reaction to Musk and to the simulation hypothesis is most people laugh and think it's highly implausible. And one of the things that I'm interested in as a philosopher of psychology is those grounds that we have for our sense of what's plausible and what's not plausible. So I think most people do have this strong sense, of course we're not computer simulations, of course Barham's story makes a lot more sense, right? But why should we accept those feelings we have at face value? So we can inquire, I think we can inquire about the plausibility of the simulation hypothesis. We could look for evidence. I made a joke about if that's in the cosmic background radiation, that would be evidence that we're in a simulation, yeah. Right? There are people who have actually looked for things in the cosmic background radiation that might look like signs from God, right? They're like, so far it's not looking like we're finding any of that, right? So that would be...
So this concept resonated with me because we can never know if we're living in the Matrix, if you'll allow me to use that analogy.
Yeah.
But science can inform, and as science advances, remember, you know, there's so much that we will know that we don't know. So there's a really important distinction between what we don't know and what we can never know. And so as we look at artificial intelligence research and how rapidly that's progressing, we could in 10 or 100 years anticipate the possibility that this could exist.
Right. So yeah, and then to thread it back to the original question about artificial life, right, which is kind of simulation of life rather than simulation of intelligence, right? Mm-hmm. If it turns out that it's relatively easy to create algorithms in computational systems that develop the kinds of complexities that we recognize as characteristic of life, and if those systems then further, it turns to be fairly easy to get them to develop into systems sufficiently complex that we would say, well, we're starting to look at organisms that have some intelligence, right? Then that would be evidence, I think, that should increase our credence that simulated beings are very common in the universe, and that then might increase our credence that we might be such simulated beings. On the other hand, if it turns out that artificial life programs don't tend to pan out very well, if it turns out that there's a lot of weird contingencies involved in creating artificial life or artificial intelligence, that's a very difficult kind of project, then that might then reduce our credence that the universe has a lot of simulated beings in it, and that might then reduce our credence that we ourselves are such beings.
What I would like to do now is, if you folks are willing, can we go a little bit longer? So some people are probably being polite and are trying to escape. But if not, then stick with us. I encourage you to move down or to move to the microphone. If you're happy where you are, so be it. I'm going to show a little bias and ask this young man over here, who's my son, to go ahead and ask a question.
So I was wondering, as a way to travel the vast distances of the universe in order to explore other exoplanets and see if life exists elsewhere, there has been the wormhole theory as a way to travel across the universe almost instantly. And I've been reading that you need some sort of anti-gravity matter to counteract the wormhole from collapsing. Could dark energy, if it would be possible to contain that, be used to contain a wormhole as a way of travel?
What are you reading? I haven't seen it. Barham, that sounds like one of yours.
Yeah, I haven't read that. I don't know. Yeah. So it's the whole concept of it's very abstract, very theory, and whether or not it exists or not, or if there is any experimental way to explore it, I don't know. As far as I know, there is none. So it's as I said, it's science fiction. So
or it sounds like a Credence thing to me.
I'm sorry? Yeah.
Sounds like something that we could explore through science to apply plausibility to it.
In my view, anything is possible until proved impossible. So I wouldn't discard that. But whether dark energy could be responsible for that again is another question. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the nature of dark energy is or what we just see is its influence on space. So the answer, I don't know. Okay. But what I do know is that the distances are too large for us to travel with the existing or future technology. Mm-hmm. The planets we have found are in the solar vicinity, and those takes light years to get to them. Mm-hmm. Meaning that you have to move with the speed of light, and that takes few years, if not hundreds of years, to get there. So it's actual impossibility for us to be able to visit them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So what I'm hearing from the management is we're far beyond how far we were supposed to go, and that's a great credit to the quality of our panel and the quality of our speaker. And so I we're happy to continue this, but what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to force intimacy. So we're going to go off microphone, and we're just going to let you guys come up and ask your questions. So on that note, what I would like to do is thank the panel, and in particular thank Barham once again for a really fantastic evening.